So I want to welcome you to another one of our regular discussions that help introduce the work of this year's Nobel Prize winners. And today we're very happy to have Xiaojian Zhao come and talk to us about this year's winners in economics. And Xiaojian is an assistant professor in the economics department. He completed his PhD at the University of Mannheim in 2010, and his research interests really coincide with the area of expertise of this year's Nobel Prize winners. He does work in contract theory, applied microeconomics, psychology and economics, and experimental economics. He has published a number of theoretical studies in economics in top journals. I won't go through those, but I think he's really the ideal person to give us a kind of deeper understanding of why this year's winners were awarded the Nobel Prize. So welcome, Xiaojian.
Okay, thank you, Albert. Thank you for the extremely kind introduction of me. And thank you all for coming. It's really my great honor to give a talk talking about the Nobel Laureate in economics this year. Actually, this is the second time for me to give a talk about the Nobel Prize. 2 years ago, I talked about John Thoreau. And interestingly, John Thoreau is also one of the greatest contract theorists in our time. He has a strong association with both Nobel laureates this year. For example, he's a consistent co-author of Holmstrom, writing influential papers in financial market liquidity, and also a textbook about financial market regulation. He is also one of the key economists criticizing Oliver Haas, incomplete contract theory about the foundation, macroeconomic foundation. So contract theory is quite important because contracts are really fundamental, and we see them everywhere in society, said by the chairman of the Economic Sciences Prize Committee. Right. So in our daily life, we know that we observe credit contracts, insurance contract, employment contract. So at a personal level, we know that marriage is also kind of informal contract. And at a societal level, we know that political constitution or law in general are part of the social contracting, right? So contracts are really fundamental and essential in our modern society. So it's very functional to let society run well. So this year, Holmstrom and Haas received Nobel Prize due to their contribution to contract theory. So we know that in economics, a key issue is to study how humans cooperate when people have different interests, right? A key assumption in economics is that people have conflicting interests. Then a contract can deal with this conflict. And contract theory here can help us understand this tension and resolve this conflict. I don't mean that contract theory can completely resolve this conflicting interest, but to some extent, in our modern society, this tension or conflict of interest can be mitigated by the contractual agreement. So here is the outline of my talk today. So in the first part, I will mention the Moore-Hazard model initiated by Ben Holmstrom. So this is a hidden action problem. So the question is how to design the contract when some parties have some actions that is not observable by the other party, okay? So due to the limit of time, I will only introduce two basic ideas. One is the informativeness principle, and the other is the trade-off between insurance and incentive in contract theory. And there's also a puzzle in contract theory showing that in our real life, the incentive power is not that strong, suggested by contract theory. So this motivates us to talk about some extensions of contract theory, both initiated by Holmstrom. One is multitasking, the other is a career concern. Okay. Of course, Holmstrom also have many different extensions in Moore-Hazard model, including teamwork, dynamic contracting, but I don't want to mention all of them in this talk. And then in the second part, I will talk about incomplete contracting theory. So here, the friction is not about hidden action, but the verifiability of some actions or contingencies. Then the solution suggested by Oliver Hart is about allocation of decision right or control right. And then, you know, this is a very important approach in contract theory. The application can be huge. You know, it's not only economics and finance, but also in organizational design, personnel economics, corporate finance, and political constitution, and also public and private ownership, and so on. It's very influential. But here, I will only talk about one application, financial contracting. But the problem here is that, you know, there's also a criticism around the incomplete contracting theory about the microeconomic foundation. So I will also talk about the intensive debate around this incomplete contracting and the story behind this debate. So in the end, I will mention some new directions. This is so-called second generation incomplete contracting model related to behavior and experimental economics. So this is motivated by the direction of bounded rationality in economics. Okay, so let's start with the Moorhauser model or hidden action problem. So the early idea is actually from Wilson, Holmstrom advisor. And then Holmstrom introduced this hidden action problem into the principal agent model. So the entire Moorhauser model builds on the principal agent relation. In particular, Holmstrom's paper assumes that there's a risk-neutral principle and there's also a risk-averse agent. So the principal hires the agent to work for them, right? And because the agent is risk-averse, risk-sharing result shows that there should be full insurance, right? So no matter what will happen in the future, you will be fully covered by the insurance. In the employment relation, you'll get a fixed pay, right? In the insurance contract, you'll be covered by the insurance service no matter what will happen in the future. But the key assumption in the hidden action problem or moral hazard problem is that the actions are not observable by the principal. Then this will lead to the moral hazard problem. So if there's a fixed pay for the employer, then the employer will shirk because the actions are not observable by the principal. In the insurance contract, if you are fully insured, right, you are safe, then you will be careless. For example, if you talk about the car insurance, then if you are you know, fully covered by insurance service, then you may very frequently forget to lock the door, and you will be careless in driving. Then this will cause the moral hazard problem, right? So here I just mentioned one recent example about the moral hazard in the principal agent relation. So this is a film star called Wang Baoqiang. Right? I think most of you may know this guy. He got some trouble in the principal agent relation. Right? You know, he's famous in the movie 天下无贼, a world without any thief. Right? And then he hires an agent called Song. Right? So in our context, in the principal agent model, Wang is the principal, and Song is the agent, right? And so Wang hires Song to work for him. And the problem here is that, you know, they have conflicting interests. That's the key assumption in economics, right? So Song is not the angel, and he may not work on Wang's behalf, right? So indeed, you know, we have a moral hazard problem, right? Moral hazard. There's a hidden action problem, so Song's actions are not observable by Wang. So indeed, he did something immoral to Wang, and serious hurting Wang. You know, this moral hazard problem, right? But this may not be so typical. I mean, a more common example in economics is the employment relationship, right? Employer can be the principal. He will hire a worker as an agent to work for him, right? For example, HKUST is the principal, right? He hires many agents, including myself, to work for HKUST, right? So this is actually the picture you took me 2 years ago when I gave a lecture about Zhong Tiro. I hope that you can work better this time as an agent to HKUST. I'm also an agent to HKUST, right? So the job of HKUST is to design a compensation rule that can induce me to work on HKUST's behalf, right? This is a contracting problem. My actions may not be observable, then there should be an incentive pay to me. Otherwise, there will be more hazard, right? Because otherwise, if there's a fixed pay, I'm fully insured, then I may spend all my time playing with my kids, who is sitting over there, and then there will be a more hazard problem, right? But the problem here is that, you know, when we look at our contract, assistant professor contract, it's more or less fixed pay. So the incentive power is not that strong. So this is a puzzle, right? Later I will elaborate why there's a low incentive power for my case. Beyond economics, you know, in politics, the citizens are also principal, right? They're the principal. They will hire politician or government to work for them, right? They need a government to enforce the contract, to protect the property, and then there can be also provision of public goods, right? So we know that in the future, they hire an agent called Trump, right? So that's their agent in the next years in the U.S. But this is contradicting to the assumption of Holmstrom model, because in Holmstrom model, the principal is risk neutral, and the agent is risk averse, right? Then there's a risk sharing problem. But in this case, he may be not that risk averse. Then he may be very risk-seeking compared to our standard model, right? So there are lots of examples. For example, the relation between the board of directors and CEO. So CEO is the agent to work for the company, and they can be also venture capitalist and also entrepreneur, right? Client and lawyer. And we know that in 2014, Zhuang Qirou analyzed, the Nobel laureate Zhuang Qirou analyzed the regulation problem, and that problem is also based on the principal agent framework, right? So because of the hidden action problem, the question here is to design the compensation packages that ties the agent's pay to the performance measure. And we can induce the agent to work on the principal's behalf, right? And the question is, what is performance? You know, we need to tie the pay to the performance, but what is the performance, right? So this leads to the informative principle, and one of the key insights in moral hazard model. And the idea is that in the optimal compensation package, we should filter out some exogenous factors. We should not pay the agent just by luck, right? This is the key message. For example, as a CEO, you know, they are the agent working for the company, then the CEO's pay should be dependent on the profit of the company and also the stock market performance of this company. And in order to provide this informative principle, we need to also filter out some irrelevant factors. For example, the pay should be also related to other firms' company and also some general industry fluctuation or macroeconomic fluctuation, right? Then we can just incentivize the agent in the right way, right? But when we look at practice, you know, there's a tension, there's a conflict, right? We found that the practitioners fail to provide such indexation to filter out the impact of exogenous factors. Because these factors are beyond the agent's control, right? We should not just pay the agent just by luck or unluck, right? The problem is that, you know, when we find the puzzle or the tension, for most cases, we should revise the theory, right? The theory should be problematic. We should revise the theory or refine the theory based on the empirical observation, right? But in some case, you know, the practice can be wrong, right? In some case, something important may be missing in practice. So Holmstrom theory is both normative and positive. It's positive in the sense that we can analyze the contract we observe in reality by contract theory. It's also normative. It means that we can also revise the contract or write a better contract according to the theory. So sometimes practice is misleading, right? And the second and the most important insight in moral hazard is the trade-off between insurance and incentive. So this is the key insight in moral hazard model. But you know, insurance is fine. If you get a fixed pay, then this is a perfect insurance, right? Full insurance. But what is incentive? How to measure incentive? This is the problem in Moore hazard model. And then Holmshaw introduced a very convenient way. It's a linear contract. The pay should be linked to the performance, right? Then we just focus on linear contract. Then there's a very analytically convenient to analyze the incentive power. So here, T is the pay from the principal to the agent, right? And X is the so-called performance or monetary outcome generated by the agent in the task, right? So this is the standard pay for performance approach. And in the pay, we found that there are two components. One is alpha, which is fixed pay, which is fixed. The other is beta times X. So this is the bonus part, right, bonus. Of course, the bonus can be also negative if X is negative, right? And then we can use just one single parameter, beta, to capture incentive power. If beta is very high, it means this contract has a high incentive power. If beta is zero, then this is more or less a full insurance, right? Okay, then Holmstrom showed that under certain assumptions, in the optimal linear contract, we can get this closed form solution for the incentive power beta. So this is very not only tractable, but also realistic in terms of empirical observation, because we often observe linear contract, right? So here, the trade-off is clear. If you just look at this formula, the noisier the social environment, the lower is incentive power, right? Because if the environment is very noisy, then no matter you get a good outcome or bad outcome, it's more or less driven by luck or bad luck, right? It's not due to your effort. And if you are very risk-averse, of course, the incentive power should be also lower, right? And if the marginal cost of effort is very high, then making effort is too costly, then the incentive power should be also lower, right? So this is a closed form formula suggested by Holmstrom. But the problem is that this is a theoretical prediction, right? This is what is suggested in theory. But when we look at the real world, the problem is that the incentive power is not that high suggested by this formula, because we widely observe low incentive in practice. And the question is why? And then Holmstrom provides some idea. One is the feature of multitasking in Holmstrom and Milgram. By the way, Milgram is also a very important contract theorist who also deserved Nobel Prize, but did not receive it so far. Right? Maybe in the future, if there's another guy getting Nobel Prize in contract theory, then it should be Milgram. And the suggestion is very sharp, because they said one some important task among the multiple tasks is hard to evaluate, then the incentive should be weak for all tasks, for all. This is quite sharp, right? An example can be teacher, So the teacher will have a multiple task. For example, some task is easy to measure, like a booming student's academic score, right? So this is easy to measure, right? At the same time, a teacher should be also working very hard to keep the student curiosity or interest in motivation in learning, right? This is very important in the long run, but very difficult to measure at the current stage, right? We know that student score is very easy to measure. Then why don't we just tie the pay to the score in a very strong way, because this is easy to measure. But the problem here is that if you do it this way, then there will be an effort substitution problem. People will switch from the effort in this dimension to the measurable dimension, right? Then there will be a crowding out effect. Then the external motivation will crowd out the interest in motivation in learning, right? So if there's some important task in the job, and this task is very difficult to measure, then all tasks should have a low incentive power. Okay, that's the key message. This can also explain why CEO in the early stage will also get a fixed pay, right? It's not that high power incentive. And for the assistant professor, you know, they also get a fixed pay almost in the beginning, in the early stage. And for the CEO, you see that there's also a trade-off between the current stage profit of the firm and the long-run benefit of the firm, right? Sometimes if they work very hard for generating the good profit today, then it will hurt the firm's long-run benefit, right? There's also a multitasking problem in corporate finance. And the evidence shows that in general, if some jobs have some narrow set of routines, then the incentive power should be high. If some job includes a wide range of duties, including creativity and many different dimensions, then the incentive power should be low. It should be a flat contract. So this is the general message we learned from the multitasking model. And the second dimension to drive the low power incentive is time. It's time. So Holmstrom introduced time into the static model and by studying career concern. So sometimes, you know, people do not need the explicit pay today because there's also a future career concern. In the future, you know, you'll be paid again, right? So in this case, the future career concern can be the substitute for the current stage incentive pay. So there are substitute mechanisms to introduce the effort for the agent. And that's why, you know, for the assistant professor, the pay is quite fixed, because there's also a future promotion possibility. And after the mid-career, there's also some mobility and also a new job possibility, right? So that's why in the early stage, they get a more or less a fixed pay. And the evidence also shows that for the CEO, it's very interesting, they get a fixed pay, right? More or less a fixed pay. But when the time is very closer to the retirement age, and they use incentive pay to substitute for the fixed pay, right? Because when they are closer to the retirement age, then there's no future anymore, right? You have to rely on the high incentive power to motivate this agent to work very hard, okay? Okay, so this is the moral hazard model, and there are also many different directions to go, right? So Holmstrom here is not only the founding father of the basic moral hazard model. He's also the guy who pointed out many different directions for the moral hazard model. So there are lots of extensions also initiated by Holmstrom. Because in the beginning, Holmstrom's academic career is more or less by chance, right? He was asked by the business sector to provide a full manual of the compensation rule. Then he thinks about many different directions to go to study the moral hazard problem. He's the founding father, but the theory in the beginning has lots of problems, right? Because it's still incomplete. One is that we show the linear contract, right? We just show the linear contract. This is very tractable and realistic, but it's suboptimal, pointed by a famous economist, Merle, right? Later I will mention Merle again. Merle is also a Nobel laureate in economics in 1996, due to his contribution in screening model, right? But still, he made a very important discovery about the suboptimality of a linear contract in moral hazard model. And he shows that we can always achieve or approximately implement the first best effort of the agent by penalizing the agent heavily for the extremely bad outcome. So this is his proposal, right? So what does it mean? Then hidden problem is not a problem at all, right? If we can always approximate the first best result, then hidden problem is not a binding problem, right? It's not that important. We can ignore it. So this is a theoretical difficulty pointed by Jim Merlis, okay? And then, but still, a linear contract is very realistic, right? We observe a linear contract in our daily life. Then we need to provide the foundation of linear contract. Then Holmstrom and Milgram think about dynamic contracting problem. And the argument is that, you know, we don't study the static contract. We evaluate the agent performance for an interval of time, right? People may work for years before the performance is measured, right? But the problem is that they study the foundation of a linear contract, you know, very ad hoc framework, very ad hoc. It's a setting in which the agent has a carrier utility, very special utility, and he has a control of some drift of Brownian motion in a continuous time model, so it's very ad hoc. And then there's some recent progress by Carroll to provide the foundation of linear contract in a more general setup. But still the question is, what is optimal contract in the static setting, right? If it is only one short contracting problem, what is optimal contract? This is still a puzzle, right? We know that Morley's discovery point out the problem of the Morley-Heisel model, and linear contract is not optimal. Then what is optimal contract? In a fairly general assumption, right? So there are, you know, some research agenda towards the optimal contracting in the static setting. In the continuum case, there's a theoretical difficulty because the incentive constraint is a continuum. It's a continuum of constraint, right? Because there's a continuum of actions and continuum of outcomes, then it's not analytically convenient to solve the optimal contract. Then there's a trick called first order approach. We can just replace a continuum of incentive constraint just by one single first order condition, right? Then the problem is easier. But the problem is that, you know, we need some assumptions. Then there's some research justifying this first order approach in some setup. And the other approach is called finite approach by Gossman and Hart. You see Hart is here, right? Hart is also working on Morley-Heisel methodology besides the incomplete contracting theory. And they give up this first order approach and remodel Morley-Heisel problem by finite actions and finite outcomes. Then Morley's trick can be ruled out because in Morley's trick, we know that you have to punish the agent heavily in the extreme outcome. But if there are finite outcomes, then each outcome will happen with a positive probability, right? Then Morley's proposal doesn't work in this setting. In their framework, they also study the shape of the optimal contract. We know that the linear contract may not be optimal, right? Then what's the shape? How does it look like, right? Then they provide a condition called monotone likelihood ratio property in which the pay is always increasing in the output, in the monetary output. So this is the condition. I know that this slide is too technical. It should not be put here. But if you are interested in the technical details, please go to my PhD class next year. So I will talk about all the details about the foundation of a Morley-Heisel model. Okay? So this is like an advertisement here at this moment. So recently, Holmstrom also works on some policy issues, right? As I mentioned before, he works with John Thiroux on financial market liquidity. He's the Nobel laureate in 2014, right? And they have some policy issues talking about financial market regulation because financial crisis is due to the liquidity shortage. And in this textbook, they talk about inside and outside liquidity. And one of the key financial market friction is Morley-Heisel problem, right? Just because of Morley-Heisel, we have some financial market friction, and those friction will create the financial market liquidity shortage. Then this will lead to the crisis, right? The building block is still Morley-Heisel model, right? So you see, Holmstrom idea does not only work in theory, but also in some practice, right? So contract theory is important. So this is basically the summary of Holmstrom's work. Now comes the second part, incomplete contract theory by Oliver Hart. The starting point is two papers, just these two papers. One with Grossman, the other with John Moore, okay? And this is also so-called the GHM property rights theory. These two papers receive huge Google Scholar citations. If we put it in the Google citation-based molecular formula, this is the molecular formula. And G for this Grossman and Hart paper, it received 10,000 Google Scholar citations, more than 10,000. And the paper with Moore received 6,000 Google Scholar citation. And Hart is here in the middle. So he received 16,000 citations just for these two papers, just for two papers. And so this is an important message for you, right? If you want to get Nobel Prize, you should be single-minded, focusing on one particular field, writing this paper with different people, right? And not the other way around, writing with the same person in different topics, then you can never get Nobel Prize, right? Because it's due to some field in which you get Nobel Prize, okay? It's very interesting because in the beginning, Oliver Hart collaborated with Sanford Grossman, right? And they also made a contribution in the foundation of Morheiser model, right? But after publishing these two papers, Grossman went to the industry to earn money. It's a pity. So he quitted academia. Then Oliver Hart went to LSE to explore new collaborations, right? Then one day, Oliver Hart sent an email to John Moore asking whether he's interested in working with him. And John Moore was very surprised, because at that moment, in RSE, he was only a PhD student, right? And Oliver Hart was not even the professor in RSE. So how come he proposed a research to John Moore? But still, I mean, of course, he agreed. It's a good opportunity, right? But after they met, you know, John Moore found that actually Oliver Hart sent an email to Merle, the Nobel laureate, in 1996. This is a mistake, just a mistake. But still, they have a huge collaboration later on, right? Okay? So this is the incomplete contracting direction, a different direction. And in this direction, the key problem is not hidden action, but the verifiability of actions or contingencies. So what does it mean? It's not in the Morheiser setting, right? Because in the Morheiser setting, we know that some party's action is not observable by the other party. But in this incomplete contracting setting, all the actions are observable. But the problem is that they cannot show the hard evidence to the court of law to verify those actions or contingencies. For example, if we ask for scrambled eggs and tomatoes in a restaurant, and in our cultural context, we all understand that this is what you expect to get, right? 番茄炒蛋, right? This is 番茄炒蛋, scrambled eggs and tomatoes. But you cannot prove to the court this is the right one. If the cook provides sufficient effort and make this one, you can still argue that this is not what you want. If the court is from a different cultural background, then he may not understand this is correct or not. If the cook provides some other 番茄炒蛋 like this, right, you cannot argue to the court that this is right or wrong, right? Because this is not verifiable. Maybe the court of law believes that the hot pot in the restaurant is a bad restaurant because you have to cook by yourself, right? But we know that hot pot is a very typical food in Asia, right? So this is a verifiability problem. Everybody can observe that whether this is the right product or not, but they cannot verify it to the court. Then this will create a hold-up problem, right? If you deliver sufficient effort to make a 番茄炒蛋 like this, right? Then the other party may say that, okay, this is not enough. This is not what I want, right? Then this is called hold-up problem, right? And taking it into account, ex ante, the cook will make under-investment, right? There will be under-investment problem. And then Oliver Hart's approach is that we can, you know, allocate the decision right or control right to solve this problem. Because by allocating this decision right, we can generate power to some party. If some party has the power to make a decision, then this can solve the under-investment problem due to verifiability problem. Okay, this is his solution by Oliver Hart. And this idea can be also applied to study the boundary of forms. And this is a question initiated by HKUST, Ronald HKUST. You know, Ronald HKUST raised a very important question. It's a very simple question, but very fundamental. What is form? Why do we need form? where's the boundary between the form and the market, right? It's a very basic but fundamental, but nobody can answer it at that moment. And then Oliver Hart can analyze this problem from this incomplete contracting perspective. So we can study the integration problem using this approach. And the idea is that when form A buys form B, then form A is the owner and form B is the worker, right? Then form A will become the residual claimant of the form. And he will have the higher incentive to make the investment because he will claim all the profit from the form, right? Then form B will have a lower incentive. But if there's no integration, these two forms are separated, then the incentive are more balanced, right? So this is the basic idea covered in this book. So this is the only book by Oliver Hart. People regard it as the book like Wealth of Nation by Adam Smith. So this is a quite informal book and capturing lots of ideas. One important application of this idea is also financial contracting, right? So in financial contracting, we talk about contingent control right. This is a contracting problem between the investor and entrepreneur, right? Entrepreneur will generate a large surplus for the company, so the entrepreneur will have the control right for the firm. So he will have the control right, as long as the firm is working well. But when there's a default, the firm goes bankrupt, then the control right will switch from the entrepreneur to the investor, right? So there will be a contingent control right or decision right. So this is an incomplete contracting approach by, again, Burton, Hart, and Moore, right? But this approach has some restriction of contractual forms, right? Alternatively, there's a methodology called complete contracting approach. The question by this approach is not about which contract for which person should own the asset. It's about what. What is the optimal contract? So there's an unrestricted contracting space, then we derive the optimal contract from a continuum of space. So this is a more fundamental in economics. So there are papers by Townsend, Gill, and Helwig using costly state verification approach, and there are also some follow-up works. This is the one approach. So if you are interested in some foundation of financial contracting, you can also go to my seminar in economics next month, talking about some progress in financial contracting. So I will give also a talk, seminar talk next month in this direction. But there's a problem in this approach. There's some criticism around this approach. This incomplete contracting paradigm was challenged by Meskin and Thiroux. And they argue that if we can design some mechanism, we let the parties play some message game, then under fairly general assumptions, this verifiability problem is not a binding problem. You know, we can still achieve the first best result by ignoring this verifiability problem. So this is a similar critique compared to the earlier Morehead problem, right? We know that Holmstrom initiated linear contract, and Marie shows that linear contract is not optimal. We can always achieve the first best. Now comes Meskin and Thiroux. They show that, okay, there's a verifiability problem, that's fine, but we can still achieve the first best result by designing the mechanism properly. Then the whole methodology breaks down in this approach. Then his student, Zigel, Hart's student, said, after his theory was challenged, Hart, at age of 60, had the intellectual courage to admit that Meskin and Thiroux were correct, and he was wrong. And he had to change the theory, and he did. So Hart and Moore show that Meskin Thiroux result, or their mechanism, can be overturned when parties cannot commit not to renegotiate of the equilibrium path, following Oliver Hart's student Zigel's environment. There's a huge debate about incomplete contracting methodology. And all those debates are covered in a special issue contract in review of economic studies in 1999. So there's a special issue in this journal capture the debate around this problem. So this is a special issue in 1999. It's published in 1999, right, 1999. So at that moment, there was only one Nobel laureate, Merlin, right? Well, he got Nobel Prize in 1996, right? He's the only one. This year is 2016, right? So after decades, you see how many of them getting Nobel Prize, right? So more than half of them receive Nobel Prize. So this is really a special issue, right? Very forward-looking. They can also predict many Nobel laureates in the next year. Okay? So this includes Meskin, Thiroux, Oliver Hart, Holmstrom, and also Merle. Right? Okay? This is too abstract, right? Let me put it in an example to show the debate. I mean, this mechanism is not exactly Meskin-Thiroux mechanism, but it's simple enough to see the idea. So it's borrowed from Ben Peras and Lippmann in 2012 in JET. And so there are two contracting parties, Bob and Sarah. And they have a trouble in their relation. Bob wants Sarah to make scrambled eggs and tomatoes, right? So this is a dish. Bob wants Sarah to make it. But here the problem is that even if Sarah can do it, she can make fanjie chao dan, right? But she does not want to make it because it's costly, right? It's very costly for Sarah, and it only generate benefit to Bob. Then she will claim that she cannot do it. She's not able to do it. But there's a verifiability problem, but no hidden action. Bob knows that whether Sarah can do it or not. So everybody knows whether Sarah can do it or not, but the court cannot observe it. Right? They cannot provide evidence to the court. Then the question for us, or for the court of law, is that can we design a smart mechanism? And in this mechanism, Sarah will always make this dish, fanjie chao dan, whenever she can do it. And there's no monetary transfer between Bob and Sarah, right? They are in a relation. It's not a market, it's not a buyer and seller, right? But whenever Sarah cannot do it, she will not make it. If she really cannot do it, there should be no trade, no so-called trade, right? Can we achieve this mechanism? If we can design such a mechanism, then verifiability is not a problem, right? Okay, let's see the mechanism. It's a three-stage game. So in the beginning, Sarah can decide whether to make this fanjie chao dan or not, right? If she makes it, then there's a welfare redistribution, right? Bob will be happier, Sarah will get some loss, right? And alternatively, Sarah can pretend not to be able to do it, right? Then Bob has a chance to challenge Sarah. There's a challenge possibility. If he challenges Sarah, this is a corresponding payoff enforced by the court. And if he agrees, in the last stage, there's a second chance for Sarah to make it. Okay, so this is the game. Then let's see whether we can achieve that mechanism. It's simple enough. Suppose Sarah cannot do it. She really cannot do it, okay? Then in the first stage, of course, she cannot do it, right? So she will say, okay, sorry, I cannot do it. Then Bob can decide whether to challenge Sarah or not. And he knows that in the future, Sarah has a second chance, right? But still Sarah cannot do it, right? So Sarah can only choose this path. Sarah cannot do it. Taking it into account, Bob will not challenge Sarah just because we assume that F1 is greater than T. If he challenges Sarah, he will get a negative payoff, worse than zero, right? So Bob will not challenge Sarah. In this case, you know, we can achieve this outcome, right? We can achieve this outcome. This is the equilibrium path. So if Sarah cannot do it, both of them will get zero payoff. There's no trade, right? And the more interesting case is that Sarah can do it. And we can show that this is also the equilibrium path. If Sarah says, OK, I cannot do it, then in this case, Bob will challenge Sarah. Just because in the future, it must be the case that Sarah will make Fanjie Chaodan, because she has a chance again, right? Because in this case, R2 is greater than T. So in the last stage, Sarah will make it. Taking it into account, Bob will challenge him, because if he makes it, the payoff is lower than this one, right? And if Bob will challenge Sarah, then in the first stage, Sarah will make Fanjie Chaodan in the first place, right? Then we can achieve this outcome. You see, we can achieve the first best solution, and this verifiability problem is not a problem at all, okay? It's a very smart mechanism. And Oliver Hart points that this mechanism will work, but it will not work if there's a renegotiation of the equilibrium path. Because you see this off equilibrium path, whenever it occurs, there's an inefficiency, right? Because both parties will receive a lower payoff, and there's an inefficiency along the off the equilibrium path. If they can talk again to renegotiate, then this mechanism will not work anymore, right? It's not only about renegotiation. And Oliver Hart also argued that this mechanism is too complicated. Right? It's hard to understand. Right? But the point by Meskin and Thiroux is that we agree this is complicated. But our point is that verifiability is not a problem. Maybe it's complicated. Maybe there's a boundary rationality or some other issue driving the implementation problem, but not due to verifiability. That's their point. Okay. So this idea is related to the early story by the judgment of Solomon, right? You know this story that there are two moms claiming the ownership of one baby, right? Of course, there can be only one true mom, right? Solomon designed a mechanism. So let's cut the baby into two. Then the true mom cry out, right? Then Solomon knows that, okay, this is the true mom. But again, there's a renegotiation problem. Because the baby is not cut at all, right? And taken into account, this mechanism doesn't work at all, right? So there's some problem of this mechanism. Then comes the second generation of the incomplete contracting model because of the debate. And then because of boundary rationality and possibility, Oliver Hart mentioned that, okay, maybe we should think about behavioral economics. So contract is a reference point. And then in this paper, they talk about the trade-off between rigidity and flexibility. A flexible contract is good, right? Because we can also adjust to different environment in the future. But the problem is that if this contract is too flexible, every party will take the best outcome as the reference point. And they will feel disappointed if the distance between their best response in the mind and the reality is too far. Then they'll be very unhappy. If they are so unhappy, they may retaliate. There'll be some shading behavior. So this causes the inefficiency. Okay? So there's a trade-off. There's a trade-off between flexibility and rigidity. And this model is not subject to Meskin Thiroux critique. So it's a behavioral economics, right? It's not that classical as before. And they also provide evidence showing this trade-off. And following this paper, you know, Oliver Hart, he presented this paper in USD before. This is a picture taken in 2007. So this is Xu Chenggang. He's now in Changjiang Business School. He was a visiting professor in USD at that moment. Then there's some also follow-up paper by Oliver Hart talking about, you know, reference points. So here, why I put this slide here, because my name is also there. So my paper and Oliver Hart paper were collected in the same special issue contract theory in games. And not only me, but also Chen Yingru. He's also the UST professor now. But he's in the ISOM department, not in the econ department. or even finance department. So this means the contract theory is really powerful, right? Because even ISOM people can apply contract theory to study supply chain management and so on, right? It's a very fundamental tool to analyze society through contract theory. And the second reason why I put here is that, recall that I put another picture about special issue in IES. At that moment, you know, only Marie got Nobel Prize, right? So at this moment, only Oliver Hart got Nobel Prize, to see my point. Okay, the other approach is cognition, an incomplete contract by Tiro. You know, Tiro comes again. And we notice a Chinese saying that, 寄生于和生亮, right? So here we can say that, 寄生 Oliver Hart, 和生 Tiro, right? So Tiro's present will make Oliver Hart very unhappy. Without Tiro, maybe Oliver Hart can get Nobel Prize much earlier. Now he introduced behavioral economics, and Tiro is still against him, talking about the classical approach to derive contractual incompleteness. So my paper is also along this line about the foundation of incomplete contract and endogenized contractual incompleteness. Okay, if you want to go deep in contract theory, there's a textbook by Patrick Borton and Matthias Devachipong. So this is the most comprehensive textbook in contract theory. Borton is actually the student of Oliver Hart, and Devachipong is the student of Eric Meskin. So they deserve writing an influential textbook in contract theory. And the other book is by Lafon and Martin Moore. Martin Moore is actually the student of Lafon. And they also talk about principal agent model. And this book is actually better in terms of textbook. And the other book is more or less a reference book. Right? It's more educational if you want to understand contract theory step by step using this textbook. Okay, here's the summary. There are two branches in contract theory. One is complete contract, the other is incomplete contract. Morheiser's model belongs to complete contracting, and Oliver Hart's model is the incomplete contract approach. In complete contracting approach, Morheiser's problem is not the only problem, right? If we put this Morheiser model in history, you can see that it's in parallel to the hidden information problem. So in this part, we have adverse selection problem initiated by Eichloff. Then Spence, Stiglitz, and Merle provide the signaling and screening device to overcome the information asymmetry problem. So they talk about some information asymmetry about some exogenous parameter in the model. And Holmstrom talk about the hidden action, which is endogenous in the model. Okay? And they all come from the general equilibrium paradigm, right? Because in the early stage, in the old days, we study general equilibrium without talking about externality, information asymmetry, and there's also no market power, right? But that's the benchmark. That's the reference point for the future extensions. And actually, Oliver Hart in the beginning also studied incomplete market in general equilibrium. Then he switched from incomplete market to incomplete contracts, okay? And from the methodological perspective, contract theory is nothing but applied game theory. Non-cooperative game theory influenced this complete contracting a lot. So this is actually the application of non-cooperative games. And Oliver Hart and John Moore also applied cooperative game theory from Shapley by studying the allocation of some ownership of asset. Because they introduced, Hart and Moore introduced multiple individuals and multiple assets, then they rely on Shapley value to study how to allocate the surplus in a more complicated setting. And incomplete contract theory also borrow a lot from law and economics, starting from HKUST, the theory of form, and later transaction cost economics by Williamson, right? So this is the picture of the economic thought. And we put contract theory in economic thought. And later, this approach is also challenged by Meskin and Tiro. And due to their challenge, Oliver Hart also refine their theory of incomplete contracting. So this is a contract theory. We know that it's very fundamental. We can also analyze a large class of social problems using contract theory, right? And at the same time, we can also provide some policy recommendation by designing better contractual agreement, right? So it's both positive and normative in contract theory. And hopefully we can use contract theory to improve our work. This is still an active research area, and we can rely on contract theory to achieve a better work. That's it. Thank you.
And let's thank Xiaojian very much for, I can see you put a lot of work into making this a better, very entertaining and illustrative talk. So thank you so much, Xiaojian.
Thank you.